So good afternoon, colleagues, presenters, panelists, and ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sanchita Basudas, and I'm an economist with the ADB and your host for today's event. So welcome to ADB, ICC, ESCAP, jointly organized webinar series on accelerating cross-border paperless trade facilitation. Our topic of discussion today is closing the trade finance gap. Next slide, please. We have certain house rules. So the Russian-English simultaneous interpretation is available for this event. Please choose Russian and at language selection button. Participants can submit their questions at Q&A box. After all presentations, we will call those who raise hand. Before you leave this webinar, please kindly fill an evaluation form by scanning or clicking a link on chat box. Next slide, please. Next slide. So in the next hour and a half, we are going to discuss the impact of the COVID-19 impact on banks' trade finance facility. We are going to hear about the different impacts of trade finance shortages on various firm sizes and availability and accessibility of digital sources of finance for small and medium enterprises. Our experts today are going to share policies needed to strengthen the way forward. To start the event today, let me introduce our three speakers for their opening remarks. Ms. Sinyang Park is Director in Economic Research and Regional Cooperation Department of the Asian Development Bank. She manages a team of experts to look into economic and policy issues related to regional cooperation among the Asia-Pacific economies. Mr. Julian Kasum is Director of Global Partnership and Development in International Chamber of Commerce. He acts as Director of the ICC World Chamber Federation while managing relations with ICC national committees in 5 continents and oversee the development of new initiatives in support of ICC's mission. Finally, Mr. Jan Duvall is Chief of Trade Policy and Facilitation Section of Trade, Investment and Innovation Division of ESCAP. He is part of many key research and technical assistance projects, including WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement, ESCAP World Bank Trade Cost Database, UN Global Survey on Trade Facilitation and Paperless Trade Implementation, and others. Without further ado, let's hear the opening remarks.
Good afternoon, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very pleased to welcome all of you to today's webinar, where we will discuss how to close the large trade finance gaps. The COVID-19 pandemic brought unprecedented disruptions to global economic and trade activities. Last year, global trade declined by a magnitude greater than that experienced during the global financial crisis. Across Asia and the Pacific, trade has been recognized as one of the most important drivers for economic growth and job creation. Trade finance is critical to trade, and its shortage during the pandemic showed how it can worsen the trade decline. While the economic recovery is underway, its prospects remain uncertain in the face of slow vaccination rates in many developing economies, threats of new virus variants, and the continued supply chain disruptions and related inflation concerns. Trade finance is often vulnerable during economic crises. It has been no different during this pandemic. While banks continue to have ample liquidity thanks to very low interest rates, their risk appetite to trade finance dwindled due to increased economic uncertainties and high cost for provision. The trade finance gap was also most immediate and severe on the smaller firms. Our study showed 40% of the trade finance rejections or from SMEs. While SMEs accounted for only 20% of all trade finance applications. Public sector, including export credit agencies and multilateral development banks like us, need to step up the support to increase availability and access to trade finance. More importantly, we need to step up utilizing the digital technology to lower the cost of trade finance and perhaps providing better data on the state of the trade finance market. This webinar provides a good opportunity to discuss the current state of the trade finance gap and how it has affected banks and borrowing firms during the pandemic. I look forward to achieve greater discussions of the policy options and suggestions for utilizing more digital solutions. Again, welcome to the webinar. I look forward to productive and fruitful discussions ahead. Thank you.
Hello, I am Julien Kassem of the International Chamber of Commerce in Paris. I would like to greet everyone today and thank the Asian Development Bank and UNESCAP for putting together such a great event on a topic which is close to our heart at ICC, taking action to close the trade finance gap. As we know, the trade finance gap has a real business impact. These are exports not happening, productivity gains not realized, and ultimately jobs not created. And the reality is that the gap is increasing year on year. But we at ICC see solutions at hand and reasons to be optimistic. We see a flurry of innovations in the market, leveraging on digital solutions. We see trade finance emerging as a new asset class. Last but not least, we see the move to paperless trade as one of the most powerful drivers of efficiencies across the whole transaction cycle. And SMEs will be among the greatest beneficiaries of this worldwide movement, of which Asia is a leader. We take all these issues seriously at ICC through our Trade Now campaign, the Digital Standards Initiative, and the Centers for Future Trade. We look forward to the outcomes of your discussion today so that we can shape a new agenda for collective action. Enjoy the panel.
Good afternoon from United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific in Bangkok. I'm very pleased to welcome you to the sixth webinar in our webinar series on accelerating cross-border paperless trade. So far we've covered quite a wide variety of topics, going from interoperability of single windows to the use of blockchain in paperless trade, to also how to exchange electronic certificates related to sanitary and final phytosanitary measures. We've also looked at broader topics such as the overall state of play of digital and sustainable trade facilitation in Asia and the Pacific, and how paperless trade could help address some of the supply chain issues that countries have been facing during the COVID-19 crisis. Today, it's going to be about trade finance. And this is really a very important topic always, in particular for small and medium-sized enterprises. We always put access to credit and trade financing as one of their major challenges and bottleneck. And so I understand from the Asian Development Bank study that actually the gap in trade financing has increased further during the COVID-19 crisis. And really there is, it's important to try and find a solution. And digitalization of the trade finance process, I think, is part of that solution. So I hope the experts today will be discussing some of this. I know in the UN Global Survey on Digital and Sustainable Trade Facilitation 2021, we have a special segment on trade finance facilitation. And we find that, unfortunately, a lot of the national single windows, the national trade single windows that countries have developed still lack the trade financing functionalities we would like to see there. So hopefully, this is one of the issues that can be discussed as well during this webinar. So a big thank you to the Asian Development Bank for leading the organization of this webinar. And Stephen Beck is there, also Alexander Malake is there, and I'm sure we will learn a lot from all the panelists speaking today. Thank you very much.
Thanks to Sinyang, Julian, and Yan for their welcome message. Moving to the next session of the event, let me introduce you the two presenters for today. Mr. Kijun Kim is economist in the Economic Research and Regional Cooperation Department of the Asian Development Bank. Since joining ADB, he has worked in many areas, including trade facilitation and trade finance within the context of regional cooperation. He is part of many ADB flagship publications, such as Asia Economic Integration Report, Trade Finance Gaps, Growth and Market Survey, and Asia Pacific Trade Facilitation Report. Our second presenter is Ms. Hannah Niu. She is Deputy Director of Digital Standards Initiative in International Chamber of Commerce. Her work focuses on engaging industry participants, standards developing organizations, solution providers, governments, and international organizations to coordinate standardization efforts across the ecosystem. Over to you, Kijun and Hannah.
Thank you very much, Sanchita. First, let me share my screen. Okay, can you see the slides?
Yes, we can see the slides.
Okay, great. Hello, everyone. My name is Kijun Kim. I'm an economist in ADB's Economic Research Department. Okay, so I'll be talking about ADB's latest knowledge product on trade finance. It's called the Trade Finance Finance Gaps, Growth and Job Survey. Okay, let me briefly introduce the survey before I present about the main findings. So our survey began in 2013, and so this year's survey is the seventh survey, and the latest one, the previous one was conducted in 2019. So the main objective of the survey is to estimate trade finance gaps and assess how banks and business borrowers are able to access it. So this year is a rather special because of the unprecedented impact of the pandemic. We got the responses from 81 banks and 469 firms, mostly SMEs. So we've this survey is in the form of online survey conducted from April to July this year. So several institutions have provided lots of support for the survey. So I, for example, ICC Banking Commission, the Center for the Promotion of Imports for Developing Countries, or CBI, and the International Trade Center, Pacific Trade Invest Australia, Global Credit Data, Central Asia Regional Economic Cooperation Program, CARIC, World Trade Organization, and the many banks and companies, firms that took time to complete our survey. So taking this opportunity, we'd like to thank our partners for their strong support. Okay, first of all, our survey shows that the size of estimated trade finance application, or trade finance gap, as we call it, it rose to $1.7 trillion in 2020 during the pandemic, from $1.5 trillion in 2018. Just to put this into perspective, this is about 10% of global trade, global goods trade. It was up from 8% in 2018. Despite the increased trade finance gap, 80% of the banks that we surveyed, they said that they did not reduce capital availability, and 70% of them did not reduce limits to support trade during the pandemic. Then what caused the increased gap? So we deem that as economic and financial uncertainties rose, firms were more likely to get rejected partially or fully in their trade finance application than before. Okay, then our survey indicates access to trade finance continued to be favorable toward larger firms. Our surveyed SMEs account for around 20% of trade finance demand, as the Sinyoung already mentioned in her opening remarks, but SME accounts for 40% of trade finance rejections. So one of the persistent factors for the rejection is that additional collateral is required to mitigate banks' risk of SME lending. And also, in addition, women-owned SMEs still face considerable difficulties in accessing trade finance. Our survey shows that among the women-owned firms, about 70% of their applications were totally or partially rejected. We asked the banks what the major barriers are to serve trade finance needs. Anti-money laundering and know your customer concerns remain the top barriers to trade finance expansion. Basel capital requirement comes next. And also firm-specific factor like their low credit rating also matters. Particularly increased economic uncertainties also acted as one of the top barriers for banks to expand their services. Many of these barriers are quite persistent. Of the top five factors identified in the current survey, four of them have been already identified in the 2019 survey. Then we asked firms what happened when their applications got rejected. So among the SMEs who got rejected, 40% of them used their own funds. A slightly higher percentage of firms used informal rather than formal financing. The take-up of digital finance remains very low at around 1% in our survey. Around 20% of companies were unable to find an appropriate financing solution, which suggests either knowledge gap or a financing product gap. Firms who looked for informal finance relied on business partners and family members and relatives first before they reach out to other informal sources. Nearly all banks surveyed echoed that the provision of trade finance is essential for their post-COVID trade growth and economic recovery. We also asked firms about the timing of expected recovery and what they need for recovery. More than half of the survey SMEs said they expect their revenues to recover to the pre-pandemic level in the first half of next year or later. A third of responding firms noted that the access to finance is critical for their recovery. And they also see that more public sector support is needed under the prolonged restrictive mobility measures, continued disruption to production or supply chain is also of major concerns. Okay, then let's talk about what we can do, particularly the role of digital technology. Advances in technologies can help address challenges in trade finance, including process inefficiency coming from paper-based documentary transactions, as well as high cost of regulatory compliance requirements and collateral requirements. So the chart you are seeing now actually shows the flow of funds, documents, and goods in trade processes. So as you see here, we already have a variety of digital technology implemented in each segment of this chain. Blockchain, artificial intelligence, machine learning already being used in digital trade finance platform. Digital documents are being exchanged through national single window or regional single windows. Internet of Things and GPS are commonly used for real-time monitoring of goods. Most banks surveyed said the pandemic has accelerated the use of digital process in their operations and that this will continue to do so. Banks acknowledge the potential that digital technology presents for SME trade finance as well. Digital technology can basically help banks deepen their knowledge about SMEs and better product for them and easier compliance checks. On why firms use digital and web-based platforms, firms highlighted practical reasons like being easy to access and low cost. However, when we look deeper into the use of technology, we see some different reality. Despite the promised gains and wide potential for growth, the use of fintech and digital solutions is rather limited and concentrated on certain areas only. So currently, many of responding banks use digital solutions for digital filing, transmission, and electronic signature platform purposes, while businesses use them primarily for digital record keeping and accounting. We asked both banks and firms, what are the major barriers to access technology then? Banks said the high cost of technology is the major constraint to maximize their potential to engage SMEs. Also, insufficient connection or lack of interoperability across different financing platforms and the lack of technological expertise are also the issues for banks. For firms, their lack of information and expertise about digital platforms are key factors which prevent them from embracing the possibilities of digital platforms. This implies that more and better training for SMEs can help them take advantage of innovative financing. Okay, since we'll be having a good discussion of policy, I'll be very brief about highlighting some key messages. Here, public sector support is vital to close trade finance market gaps, particularly during the difficult times, but the private sector must play a larger role as main market players. And to realize potential digital technology, global standards and protocols are required. Digital documents should be recognized in law. Ultimately, global standard will drive interoperability between various platforms and between stakeholders in the trade ecosystem. And greater inclusion of women throughout the global financial system is important to close trade finance gaps. More capacity building targeted at women-led businesses and opening networks to include women will also help close these gaps. Last but not least, transparency in supply chain will help identify bottlenecks that disrupt production and delivery of important goods, ultimately locate where trade finance support should go. So this is all I have. Thank you for your attention. If you'd like to explore more details from our surveys, please visit our website. Thank you very much. Okay, Hannah, floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Kim. Could the organizer help me to put up the slides, please? Thank you so much. It's my absolute pleasure and privilege to be here today on behalf of the Digital Standards Initiative. My name is Hannah Nguyen, Deputy Director of the DSI. And thank you so much, Mr. Kim, for the excellent summary of the ADB survey. Next slide, please. So before we begin, let's do a quick mini poll among our audience. If you could put in your chat box, what is the first word that comes to your mind when we mention the word standard? I have some suggestions over here on the slide that you may see, but of course, I expect a fully diverse array of responses coming from our audience today. And so while you're putting that response into the chat box, let's just go through some of the usual answers that we get when we ask people this very question. So for some of you, you may think about ISO, right? Because these are quality management and environmental management standards, which are used by many companies and organizations. Some of you may think about the standardized cargo container that we see, which is ubiquitous in today's global supply chain. But thanks to this gentleman who is the father of containerization, he was the one that actually standardized the size of the boxes that actually go on all the ships around the world. And again, some other examples, some people may think about email systems, which you and I use on an everyday basis right now. And thanks to the standardized network protocols, we are able to choose any email service provider of your choice, use it on any device, and able to get the electronic message to anyone halfway around the world. Next slide, please. So let's talk a little bit about the Digital Standards Initiative, where I come from. So this project was born in the middle of the pandemic in 2020, and is housed under the umbrella of ICC with support from the Asian Development Bank and the Government of Singapore. And on our governance board, we also have prominent public policy and international organizations, including the World Trade Organization and the World Customs Organization. Our main aim really is to accelerate that journey of the global supply chain towards a globally harmonized and digitized trade environment. And in that ideal world, you would have efficiency, you would have scalability and inclusion. In the same way that ISO standards help us to have efficiency processes, in the same way that standardized containers help us to achieve scalable supply chain, and in the same way that standardized email protocols help us to improve inclusion in global communications. Let's go to the next slide, please. So I want to repeat the summary of the excellent ADB Trade Finance Gaps Growth and Jobs Survey that Mr. Kim had just went through. I will just highlight two major findings which really stood out for me in this survey. The first thing is, besides the headline numbers, which is really staggering at $1.7 trillion in terms of the trade finance gap, we see that 40% of trade finance applications rejected by banks are actually from SMEs. And so they really suffer disproportionately in terms of not being able to access that trade finance. And the second finding, which really is outstanding for me, is that digitization has a huge potential to help to close that gap by proving the credit worthiness of the potential borrower, and also offering digital trade finance solutions through the use of fintech platforms. But however, as Mr. Kim has pointed out, the use of digitalization remains rather restricted in certain very basic functions, such as record keeping, filing, accounting, and so on. And so to actually arrive at that, more ideal state where we have data and digitalization helping companies, especially MSMEs, access trade finance, we need global standards and legislation in order to drive interoperability among the various platforms available and also among the various actors in the global supply chain. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's recap some of the pain points, and some of this could also, remind you of some of the points raised earlier by Mr. Kim. When we don't have digitization at scale, all that data and information is trapped in the ecosystem or in paper documents which are difficult to extract. And so the result is that MSMEs face very high barriers to liquidity. And because they cannot simply meet the risk assessment criteria from banks or alternative financing providers to prove their credit worthiness. And from the bank's perspective, as much as they like to help MSMEs, especially in this time of difficulty, the limited access to historical data actually constrains the ability to extend credit. And the same constraints would apply to other alternative finance markets. And on the operational point of view, it's complex to manage trade finance transactions for both the financing providers and the customers because the workflows span multiple parties. I refer back to that excellent diagram that Mr. Kim just showed us a few moments earlier, when you had that flow of goods, funds, and payments. So there are many parties involved, and even though a lot of technologies are available, the fact is that there is still significant manual work involved, and typically information exchange takes place on paper, courier to courier. And there's also a proliferation of platforms that is available that helps to digitalize certain areas, but in a very piecemeal fashion. So it's not integrated, it's not seamless, it's not end-to-end. And one of the reasons mentioned by the survey is that the lack of interoperability is one of the key reasons why we don't see adoption at scale. And the last point, which I want to reiterate, is the high cost of training and technical integration in the for the users and for the corporates and SMEs. This would actually really constrain the ability of MSMEs to actually get that valuable data to the financing providers. And last but not least on this slide, the lack of enabling legislation, which would provide that environment for digital data and documents to actually flourish and be recognized in the same way as paper. So for instance, remember that diagram where we have different actors in the supply chain that we saw earlier from Mr. Kim. If we have one part of the supply chain which is digitized, for instance, between the bank and the SMEs, but let's say in other parts of the supply chain, for instance, at the border process, in interaction with other countries or with other border agencies, if there is still requirement for paper, then usually what we see is that the whole process will actually revert to paper as the common denominator. So all these different requirements across jurisdictions, across businesses and government agencies is some of the obstacles behind the reason why we don't see digitization at scale. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's go to the reverse side of the situation. What do we have when we have global standards underlying all the different processes and actors in the supply chain? And when we have enabling legislation which allows digitized information and data to be exchanged in a legally recognized and trustable manner. What you have would be the exchange of data, which is trusted, secure, and transparent from the sources of data, which are golden sources, to the people that need them when they need them. So for instance, you would be able to establish and recognize and reconcile the digital identities of each trade participant. You would be able to simplify the KYC, AML, and sanctions screening process. You would be able to have a faster and better informed credit risk assessment on the part of financing providers, and not only making the life easier to approve that transaction, it's also easier to track that transaction in its life cycle from end to end. You would have full visibility, real-time tracking, and able to actually exchange documents in a legally recognized environment globally. So for that, we have common standards and protocols, enable everyone to choose the service provider of their choice. Everything would be portable. You would choose the technology and the vendor that you need, and then you would be able to leverage the trade finance solutions through fintech platforms. And last but not least, very importantly, this improved transparency will increase the liquidity in the trade finance markets. Next slide, please. So in the second part of my presentation, let's go through very quickly some of the work that we have been doing at the Digital Standards Initiative in the last 12 months to enable solving for some of these challenges that we have just talked about. The first pillar of work that we are very focused on is actually enabling access to existing global standards. So what you see is a snapshot of some of the parts of our website, which is a comprehensive knowledge center. You will have a link to this website at the end of my presentation. What you see over there, you will be able to see some of the standards that are already available that we are advocating for. So for instance, we are advocating for identity standards such as LEI and DID specifications. We are advocating for standards in electronic title documents, such as electronic bills of lading by the DCSA, and also advocating for unique document creation and validation frameworks, such as Trade Trust and ITFAS DNI initiative. We also have a specific page for policymakers on how to actually enact the UNCITRA model law on electronic transfer records to create that enabling legal environment in your jurisdiction. Second, next slide, please. Okay, and on pillar number two, we are very mindful of inclusive co-development with industry. So in the last 3 months, we have been busy constructing an industry advisory board, which helped us to get that cross-regional and cross-industry representation, which helps inform which are the first order priorities that we need to solve at the DSI. So on this slide, you see logos of various organizations involved in this board, both from the public and private sector, from industry organizations, and also companies who are importers, exporters. You have freight forwarders, you have ocean carriers, you have banks, and various industries ranging from retail to commodities and so on. So this very diversity is going to help us focus and solve the most important pain points that span across the supply chain. Next slide, please. Okay, and pillar number three, creating the enabling legal environment in terms of both public and private law. So on the public law, I have talked about the need for jurisdictions to align to the model law on electronic transferable records. And on the private law side of things, we are very busy engaging with industry to create common rule books that will work for everyone, and also to simplify and commercialize the digital workflows, especially for trade finance. So one of the instances I could mention is the commercialization of EUCP. So this is something that probably for non-bankers, you may not have heard about, but this is simply a best practice guide to help financing service providers how to actually operationalize the electronic presentation of digital title documents when you have letters of credit process. And the next slide, please. This is actually, I think, the last slide I have for you. These are just some resources I would like to leave you with. The first one on the left is a paper that we recently published last week on reconceiving the global trade finance ecosystem. And on this right side inside, what you have is actually a practical step-by-step guide to legal reform to create a modern digital trade ecosystem. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Kijin, and thank you, Hannah, for your very insightful presentation. While we heard from Kijin about this state of trade finance and the challenges therein, we heard from Hannah about the standards and the digitalization. Moving to the last segment of today's webinar, let me invite Mr. Stephen Beck, Head of Trade and Supply Chain Finance of the Asian Development Bank, to chair our panel discussion. Mr. Beck has many successful initiatives under his belt. To name a few, he initiated a tool that maps the entire supply chain for COVID-related goods to address shortages. He initiated the trade finance register of the ICC. Under his leadership, ADB started the study on trade finance market gaps and their impact on economic growth and jobs. And there are many more, like increasing women's participation in banks, promoting digitalization of supply chain and global trade and others. Without taking any further time from the next session, let me welcome Stephen to lead the panel discussion. Over to you, Stephen.
It seems like Stephen has having some technical issues. So while we're waiting for him to come back, so may I kindly ask Ian kind of to start the discussion until, you know, Stephen is coming back. Would that be okay, Ian?
Thank you, Kijin, yes. Thank you for that introduction. Let me know when Stephen is back online and then I happily hand over to him. Perhaps you know, this previous presentation is really highlighted. Ah, there we go.
There is Stephen.
Sorry, back to you. Get back in. Anyway, my apologies, everyone. I'm really delighted to be part of this thing. I think what you guys have presented, Kijin and Anna, thank you very much for that. Comes down to the crux of a lot of really fundamental issues. I mean, you know, the United Nations Declaration on Financing for Development said that without sufficient financing to back trade, we're not going to be able to achieve our SDGs, right? The Sustainable Development Goals. And yet, as Kijin, you know, presented, we see that there's a huge gap, trade financing gap. Companies are not getting the kind of backing, financial backing they need to grow, to create jobs, growth, and to achieve a lot of the Sustainable Development Goals. So it's a big problem. And then as Hannah pointed out, and this is touched on in the study that ADB put together on the gaps, digitalization of global trade and supply chains can address a lot of the core problems with respect to closing those gaps. Hannah, you articulated it very clearly about the kind of metadata that we could generate from seamless digital trade, if we could have those transactions running without any paper friction between, you know, exporters and shippers and ports and customs and warehousing and importers. It's amazing the kind of metadata that we could get. And on one level, again, as you pointed out so interestingly, Hannah, in some respects, it's so simple. We just need some some common standards and protocols. And I love that example about the container, the size of a container. Can you imagine the impact that had, how it revolutionized global trade to just agree on the size of a container so that then it can properly fit on a ship, can properly fit on a train, can go onto a truck, and the impact that that would have and did have on the world. And then your example about, you know, without the protocols and standards, we wouldn't be able to send each other email messages and so on. So, but of course, it's easier said than done. And it's like herding cats, you know, to get all of these disparate efforts, you know, aligned so that we can agree globally on these standards and protocols that'll help us realize that seamless digital, that sort of global supply chain and trade ecosystem that'll close those financing gaps, but also enable us to drive transparency through global trade and supply chain so that we can do things like monitor the environmental and the international labor standards, for examples, throughout the supply chain. So critical stuff. And the work that the Digital Standards Initiative is doing is I really do believe that we'll look back in history at this next sort of great leap in global trade, this digitization of trade. And we'll look back and the historians will see that the Digital Standards Initiative played a pivotal role in us moving forward on, you know, on so many of these issues. So thank you for that. We have a really interesting panel with us to discuss some of these issues and more. And so I'm going to ask the panel to sort of introduce themselves. We're going to start with Ian. And Ian, if you could, give us a sense, please, for where you were, because I think the International Trade Center, which has been a great partner for us on many different fronts, including the trade finance gaps growth and jobs survey. A lot of people don't maybe understand where the ITC fits in the sort of rubric of international institutions and so on, and your role there, please. Ian.
Thank you, Stephen. And thanks to the previous panelists who have done such an excellent job at setting the foundations for our discussion. I certainly learned a lot from Hannah's and Kishin's presentations. So look, the International Trade Center is the United Nations agency responsible for sustainable trade and enterprise development. And so our objective is really about creating job opportunities, especially for women and young entrepreneurs, poor communities, and by connecting enterprise of all sizes with global value chains, and particularly from developing countries. Now, we know Asia and Africa and other parts of the world that more than 80% of our supplies, which we see in our retail shops and which businesses buy, come from developing countries. And we also know that 80% thereabouts or more of the enterprise in those countries are classed as MSMEs, micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises. So when we look at the results of what's come out of the survey and Hannah's work, and when we look at the drive now towards greater awareness of environmental, social, and governance ratings along supply chains, we ourselves are focusing on what the enterprises can do, how they can change and adapt to actually not be excluded, if you like, by these momentous changes, which are happening rapidly in some parts of the world. Downstream in your supply chains, they're happening very rapidly with businesses facing consumers and customers. But upstream, that's where the real challenge is for us, before the goods actually get packaged and shipped, if you like. So we're working with thousands of enterprises across more than 120 countries. 20 of them, at least, are in the Asia and Southeast Asian region and the Pacific. Thank you.
Thanks, Ian. Thanks very much for that. And so, organizations like ours will work fairly upstream, as you say. We'll work with governments to try to enact, for example, the kind of laws that Hannah was talking about that are required to move digitization forward, to recognize electronic documents in law, for example. To get the sort of more downstream, the real world perspective on what's going on, we're really delighted to have Chandni Jha with us from Lakshmi Bank in Nepal. And they've been a great partner of Asian Development Bank's Trade and Supply Chain Finance Program. We've done deals together for years, and they've been great partners. So Chandni, it's very nice to have you with us. Would you tell us just a bit about yourself and your bank in Nepal, please?
Thank you, Stephen. Hello, everyone. I'm Chandni. I'm from Lakshmi Bank, and I head trade and international business. I've been heading this department for the last 7 years. So, like Stephen said, we are delighted to have this partnership with ADB, and I'm really glad to be here today. So, looking forward to the discussion. Yeah.
Thanks very much, Chandni. And if we go off into the clouds too much, then you rein us in, okay? And tell us, hey, wait a minute.
Sure.
This is going on in the real world. Thanks, Chandni. Alexander Malakat, full disclosure, we've known each other probably for too many years. Are you still awake, Alexander? It's almost 4 o'clock in the morning.
I am. I have been enthralled by our speakers and presenters. So yes, I'm absolutely wide awake. Thank you.
Alexander, you wear many hats. You've done many things. You've written books on trade and supply chain. Created the nomenclature, right, for supply chain finance so that everyone uses the same terminology so that we all know what we're talking about in the industry. And you've done many other things. Would you give us a smattering for the different hats that you wear, please?
Sure. Thank you, Stephen. And thank you, everyone. Delighted to be here as well. Despite having just come back to Canada from Singapore, where it's now promising to snow in the next 24 hours, which I'm not pleased with. Stephen, thank you. Look, for that very kind introduction. I consult in international trade, trade finance, and it's kind of an international development and inclusion angle. And more recently, in the last year and a half, with a focus, Ian, to your point, about ESG and how it relates to international trade and supply chain. So those are the sort of three, four areas broadly that I'm active in. Have the privilege of working with some outstanding clients and partners, including ADB, including ITC in the past, and including our various friends at the UN, as well as, of course, ICC and DSI. It's been extremely rewarding to be on the front lines of some of the initiatives that we're all talking about today, Stephen, including with your team in the survey and in terms of some of the work we're doing around the trade finance gap and the KML, AML KYC piece of things, which we'll be getting into in this discussion as well. So delighted to be here with all of you. Thank you.
Thanks for joining, Alexander. Ian, you guys do a fair bit of work with SMEs. I imagine they've gone through a hell of a time post-Armageddon and during the pandemic. Would you give us a flavor for what you've seen them go through and how ITC has been trying to make a difference, been trying to help things along? And then maybe after that, I'll go down to Chandni and ask her what she's seen in terms of her SME clients, what they've been going through and how Lakshmi Bank has been handling that. Ian?
Thank you, Stephen. Yes, look, SMEs tend to be pretty resilient by nature. You know, if you're a small enterprise and you've been in business for 3 years or more, and you've been exporting or trading, then generally speaking, if you're in a developing country, you've had to survive at least one major crisis in your business life. So to be quite honest, what we're finding is that the enterprises we're working with, for sure, they had some shocks. For sure, supply chain issues or container shortages, all this kind of thing have made their lives more difficult, have increased their costs of getting stuff to the point of shipment, for sure. But generally speaking, they had a dip and now they're coming back. In many of the countries where we're working, we're actually finding that enterprises are getting into new business. You know, they've been literally exploratory as best they can. They've been using our services to find out about market compliance issues, to pivot to new markets, what kind of new types of packaging and labeling they're going to need, all these kind of things. It takes time. But the key point here is that all these adaptations, of course, they need money, cash. And in times of COVID, we found that investing generally, because of long-term uncertainties, has fallen off a cliff. It's maybe 17% of what it was pre-COVID in 2019. So that's taken a major dive. Friends and family, certainly in 2020, that almost dried up completely because people needed money for themselves. And they've, in a way, been relying on buyers' advances. But as you know, when we get into sort of supply chain financing, that kind of ties them down to just being able to spend the money on the product that the buyer is going to get. So when we're talking about how to support the costs of increasing digitization, of buying an accounting application, or even simple things like that, or pivoting to new businesses, there's a real shortage of cash in that area, which is kind of hindering their agility. And we've been trying to address this by various sort of stopgap measures like guarantees and things, but we can talk about that later.
Yeah, thanks, Ian. And Chandni, what are you seeing on the ground? I mean, I guess Ian's saying, you know, they've taken a hit, but they're resilient. They're starting to pivot a bit. They're coming back. But you know, they're often finding it tough because of a lack of finance. What are you seeing on the ground with your clients? You see that kind of resilience?
That's true to some extent. If I have to talk about my bank, like I was sharing earlier. We have actually our SME portfolio during this pandemic, that is 19, has actually grown by 15%. You know, so that
in this case, I suspect it's not Shandni's fault. It's the connectivity. The previous one was my fault. Alexander, any thoughts? If not, I'll jump back to Ian. I've got another question I'm ready to fire.
No, so just very quickly, I really appreciate the perspective, Ian, that you brought forward in terms of the resiliency of the SMEs. So one of the things that we're working on in another capacity, Stephen, you're aware of this organization called the World Trade Board, is a paper that talks about how our outlook on SMEs and our perspective on SMEs often puts them in a kind of a victim posture in terms of saying we need to help them, we need to create enabling environments, and there are some significant challenges they face, and all that's true. But I think remembering how tough it is to start a business and make a business sustainable over a period of, as you said, 3 years or longer, that kind of critical time frame, is something that bears remembering as we think about how to close the trade finance gap. So from an SME perspective, the only other thing I would say is typically an SME lives and dies by cash, right? There isn't time for extended payment terms. There isn't time for worrying about things like ESG and sustainability and other things that could and should be priorities when you don't have enough cash to make it to the next month. So this trade financing discussion is part of a broader access to finance conversation that's fundamental to SMEs and their recovery post-COVID.
Yeah, Alexander, we'll get on to the digitalization, and maybe I'll reference that. There's a study that came out with HSBC and I think Boston Consulting Group around SMEs and digitalization, some of the challenges there. But Ian, I wanted to just sort of probe you a bit on SheTrade. We are looking at, full disclosure, maybe partnering with you guys on SheTrade. You can maybe get a little bit into the weeds on this. It's a fascinating website for those of you, or platform rather, who haven't been exposed to this. It's incredibly well laid out. It provides a great deal of information, really useful, nicely packaged, not the kind of thing where you're nodding you're falling asleep. Really practical, useful information for SMEs, of course, women-led SMEs. In addition to providing that information, it creates a network for women-led and owned businesses to do business together. And I think there are also some financing sort of components, or at least a training associated with that. And Ian, just before I give you a chance to answer that, I'm going to jump back to Kijin. Kijin, what are some of the numbers on the how underserved women-led SMEs businesses are? It's off the charts, right? It's crazy.
Yeah, so like I presented, 70% of the women-led businesses, you know, but just as one disclaimer, so, you know, we are based on some samples, so it may not, you know, may not be the exact numbers, but, you know, the number for this year is that 70% of women-led businesses, they've got rejected, you know, partially or fully. So, you know, this is it's really high number. So, but I think, you know, basically we are trying to measure, you know, the male-led businesses and female-led businesses. But for during the pandemic, both genders suffered. But, you know, I would say, you know, it's not just the female-led enterprises that has suffered during the pandemic, but particularly, you know, women usually were more likely to get rejected in the past surveys.
Thanks, Kijin. And Tori, Ian, before I see Chandni, are you back?
Yes, I'm back, Stephen, but allow me to turn off my video since my connection is not stable.
Sure. Yeah, you were talking about how you guys increased your portfolio of SMEs by 50% over the.
Yeah, that was 15. Sorry, it was not 50. It was 15. 15.
Okay, 15. Well, still, yeah. That's great. So how did that happen? What you could tell the backstory there. It's interesting.
Yes, it is interesting actually because our focus has been to grow our SME portfolio for quite some time now. So we are focusing there, and what we saw is it was pointed out that these customer base, they are resilient. They are they can bounce back faster than others. So and. Because we did not have this requirement to cut down on the limits or reduce our capital base to support them. So our funds were available and our focus was there. So I think that is the main reason why we chose to grow, and we did grow by 15%. But like I was saying earlier, if we look at the exposure of these segment of customers in our overall trade portfolio, it just accounts for 10 to not even 15%, you know, so that could imply that somewhere they are not aware of the trade technicalities, or somewhere they are not aware, you know, how to do the import business, or they choose to do it in a more simple way, send advance payment rather than opening a letter of credit. So that could be a possible reason why their trade exposure seems to be considerably low compared to other. Segment of customers. Yeah,
that's interesting, Chandni. Well, maybe we could talk about providing some training to your customers in conjunction with Lakshmibek.
Absolutely.
On trade finance, we have a lot of those modules. And just before I go to Ian, because this does link into the training, because we were, I don't know if you caught this bit, Chandni, but we're talking about how ITC offers training to entrepreneurs, women entrepreneurs. It's called a platform called SheTrade, which we're thinking of partnering with them. And then we would provide that to our partner banks like Lakshmi to offer to their clients. Do you guys, just before we go to Ian on SheTrade, do you guys have anything that's targeted to women entrepreneurs specifically?
We as in Lakshmi Bank?
Yeah, I know most banks don't. I'm just sorry, I don't mean to put you on the spot or anything.
Stephen, I'm afraid we have not specifically targeted the women entrepreneurs. They do get a priority when it comes to giving loans to them, short ticket size loan to them. You know, that also qualifies under our deprived sector lending. So that's there. And these kind of micro enterprises, which is led by the women's, are given a priority. And they, like I said, they are a part of our directed lending, deprived sector lending. So that is there, but specifically designed program for them, I'm afraid we've not done anything like that. Yeah.
Okay. Well, maybe there's a good opportunity for us on this, the SheTrade thing. So Ian, you want to share with people what this thing is, please?
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, our SheTrades program in ITC, which is managed by Vanessa Erokbokpo, is really designed to target these, we can say it now, historic deficiencies in or biases, if you like, in many countries, which have held back women as entrepreneurial spirit and their entrepreneurial drive and not recognize their skills as managers of businesses. Just a quick plug in ITC, there, you know, we've been looking at this from two perspectives. One is, of course, a United Nations organizational perspective and the SDGs, but also for being able to make this a lasting, if you like, community, something which goes beyond individual funded projects and a UN agency's budget constraints, we've set up two internet sites that might be interesting for women who are, in fact, for all of us should be interesting, who are actually participating here today. One is if you go to our www.intrasend.org site and look for SheTrades Invest, you will find a lot of stuff there that we do as a UN agency. But then the team has been careful to build a much wider community of women entrepreneurs of different abilities who are now interacting ferociously, I have to say, with each other across the world and exchanging mentorship, exchanging advice, guidance, working on solving issues and challenges. And this is actually available through something called SheTrades, one word, SheTrades.com. Mm-hmm. So this is a way that we've used to try and perennize, if you like, the work, the good work that we're doing, and recognizes the strength of women entrepreneurs across the world who want to help each other.
Well, as I say, when someone told me, oh, we're thinking about partnering and so on, we were talking about budget and this, that, the other, I sort of rolled my eyes, and they showed me the thing, and they were like, all pretty psyched on it and keen, and they talked about this networking business where it's Ian saying, you know, they're actually doing business on the platform and so on. And I've asked for the numbers and, you know, the statistics on that. Is it really happening? It's, if you guys get a chance to check it out, it's really, really very interesting. I'm going to pivot. Yeah, Ian, do you want to say something before?
Sorry, just one other thing to add.
Yeah.
Chadney and other bankers who may be listening to this session here, we find this also provides quite an incredible pipeline for what bankers refer to as origination. Yeah. In other words, enterprises that we actually have surveyed and we know quite a bit about, and we can then ask those enterprises if they're willing for us to share that information with financing providers of different types that might be relevant to them. So this is another way where having digitized, if you like, some of the results, provided some tools and assistance that these enterprises, some of whom we've known for quite a few years, can then be eligible, more eligible than they were before for financing.
Sure. I'm just going to try to pivot back to digitalization. And do you know about the study that I was referring to before, the HSBC Boston Consulting Group thing that came out, I don't know, like I think it was last month, and they were estimating how much money it would cost for training, but also software or whatever, to ensure that we don't leave SMEs behind in this drive to digitalize. Did you see that thing then? Sorry, by the way, for those of you who are watching, I'm the nightmare moderator, because I don't think I've asked one question that was on the agreed list. So my apologies to everyone on the panel, but I think, you know, you guys know your stuff, and it's good fun. So Anna, does that study, does it ring a bell? Anna, you're on mute, or maybe you don't want to. Oh, I'm not alone. Oh, good. You're looking for the thing too.
Hannah, you're muted.
Yeah, you're still on mute, Hannah.
Sorry about that. Yes, Stephen, I was actually looking at that right now. It looks like a very interesting study. HSBC and Boston Consulting just released a report that you say last month, right, in October.
Yeah.
And they are talking about a $50 trillion challenge. Is that the one?
Yeah, that's it. I thought, you know, when we all talk about this digitalization and so on, I mean, every now and then there's someone who likes to raise actually the deputy director general for ASEAN mentioned this when we were talking about digitalization some weeks ago, and he said, well, you know, how do the SMEs actually, how do we ensure that they're not left behind in this whole drive? And Hannah, is that something, again, my apology, I'm the nightmare moderator, but is that something that we're conscious of as we think about standards, that there needs to be a sort of an easy way to sort of plug in, if you will, open platforms, this, that, the other, is that sort of thing discussed when it comes to, you know?
Yes, yeah? Certainly. Yeah, I mean, Steve, this is something that I think was set up at the onset of, at the conceptualization of the DSI in terms of what we aim to achieve, and also because it's housed under the umbrella of ICC. And our whole mission is to make business work for everyone, everywhere. So that inclusiveness is always one of the driving factors behind everything we do. So for instance, one of the key priorities as we set up at the DSI in the first few months was actually interviewing across the whole board, big and small companies, what are the pain points? And when we discover that there's a lot of standards that are actually available but not yet adopted, we made a point to consolidate that in one place to make sure that everyone can actually access that without having to go to too many different sources. And because that is something that we know is not something doable for majority of companies, especially for our small, medium and small enterprises. And on the second point, I think one thing which is very important we are mindful is to actually elevate this process. We're actually thinking of publishing like a small standards map early next year and make it even more targeted. So let's say if you are SMEs in a certain sector, let's say you are SME in the, exporter, or you're SME freight forwarder, and you are struggling to find where to get the standards that are open source to adopt in your process, you can actually use that from our website early next year. So that is something that we're busy working on to make this especially easy for SMEs to actually leverage.
Okay, well, thanks for that, Hannah. That's interesting. It's good to know.
And Stephen, can I be the nightmare panelist and just jump in because I feel like it? Is that okay?
No, that's good. That facilitates, you're not being difficult. Anyway.
Thanks for that. Hannah, that was very impressive, sort of thinking on your feet. Let me go get a look at this report as the moderator asked me the question. I tip my hat to you on that one. That was really good. Guys, I just want to jump in very quickly to actually answer your question, Stephen, around the SMEs and whether people are thinking about this, right? We all know this in the international institutions, in the public sector, in the private sector, that SMEs are the economic driving force at national levels and on a global level. Like when people look at SME economic value creation proportion to GDP, it's always a very significant number. And it doesn't matter whether you're in sub-Saharan Africa, in South Asia, or in an OECD economy. It's consistently the reality, economically speaking. In the private sector, which we don't really have the voice of here on this panel in any significant way, I guess, Chani, other than yourself from a financial sector perspective, it's interesting to note that there is increasing attention to the SME question. So more and more financiers and more businesses are thinking about so-called deep tier financing and how you get to the SME and the microenterprise. And there are some very specific tactical non-ivory tower kind of activities going on. And I'll speak to one because I happen to know about it, one of the multi-bank initiatives called the Trade Information Network that we based out of London, which I worked with for about 3 years. And these are, you know, it was initially 8 of the top global trade banks that were involved in this. There was a very specific intent to say, we're going to build this platform that's going to involve data exchange that will help certain techniques of supply chain finance initially and then broaden out to other techniques of financing, but that it would actively and intentionally ensure inclusion of the SME suppliers in that ecosystem. So I just want to bring out that the private sector is also more and more conscious of that SME part of the equation as we look at supply chains, instead of just looking at trade as a kind of a bilateral transaction between one buyer and one seller. So that ecosystem view is helping us a lot in making sure that that SME consciousness increases everywhere.
Yeah, thanks for that, Alexander. Chandni, I'm gonna ask you in a second, so this is fair warning, or is it? I don't know, but, you know, this talk of digitization, I mean, you know, we work with our partner banks, and I know that first of all, the banks say, oh, wow, you know, this tech is expensive, first of all. We don't know if this tech is the right tech. Maybe there's some other tech that comes along that's going to be better than, you know, than the other tech. And then we're, you know, we've spent all this money for nothing. It's hugely disruptive to business processes. It's very timely. Then we've got to think about onboarding all of our clients, right? And you've mentioned you guys have a portfolio of SME and growing clients. I mean, how does, you know, your, it doesn't, you know, not necessarily Lakshmi specifically, but, you know, how does your average, you know, bank in Nepal or whatever deal with that? What's the thinking? I'll give you a few minutes, because I think Hannah, did you want to add something onto what Alexander was saying? Hannah? I see flashes, yes, of emails. I don't, and I'm very slow, as those of you who know been working with me for years. So I, yeah.
Yes, I mean, in terms of SME, you know, being able to being unable to access all these different solutions and asking those. I think to your point about, you know, there's so many different things out there that it seems to be available, but how do you actually leverage that? And to a lot of SMEs, the cost of actually onboarding those solutions are really high. Because if you go and connect to, I mean, it's all fine and good that you have different solutions out there, but then if you need to onboard and you need to actually show, you know, various documents to be on, you know, registered on there, and then you need to connect to one platform to be connected to one bank, and then maybe another platform for other banks, that is actually a huge nightmare, right? They don't have the capital and the people and the capability to actually get around that. And to our panelists' earlier point, you know, their problem may be how to survive for the next month. So actually, how do we reconcile some of these challenges is, I think, one of the issues. And again, we're coming back to standards a little bit, because we are very mindful of the fact that we need to make sure that we don't have a monopoly of, you know, a small number of fintech providers who actually so-called dominate the scene, and so everyone had to flock to them and actually have to go through this entire process. We want to actually enable inclusiveness by opening up the gates, by making sure that even, you know, a small service provider or alternative financing provider could actually use the harmonized standards to provide innovative solutions for their local community. So that enables choice, enables portability. So for every use case out there, for every business out there of any size, any sector, any geography, there is something out there for you. And so that is the end vision that we are trying to enable through this harmonization of standards and legislation to make that happen on a wider scale.
Thanks for that, Hannah. That's really encouraging. And I guess as we move along, we'll need to figure out how we communicate exactly what you just said, right? To I guess to banks and to their clients, you know, so that people do actually move up the curve on the digitalization. So Chandni, back to you, and then I'll go away. Ian, I think you want to pitch in there. So Chandni, what are you seeing on the ground, and how does your average bank sort of deal with all of those sort of considerations in the context of, you know, digitalization? Yes. And clients and stuff?
Yes, Stephen. Well, talking about Lakshmi Bank and our Nepalese banking industry as a whole, we do recognize that there is absolute need to move away from this predominantly paper-based environment that we still operate in. And especially during this pandemic, it made us realize so much that, you know, it may not always be possible to stick to our files or, you know, our workspace or our workstation. So we do realize that there is a need now to shift, to make a shift towards digitalization. We have taken, Lakshmi Bank has taken a baby step towards it. I wouldn't say we have implemented some high-tech software or something like that. No, but we have taken a small step whereby we have developed an in-house trade system which allows us to kind of record all the trade transactions, digitize the documents, generation of swift messages, and all kinds of reports which we need for our central bank reporting or for our internal purpose, you know. But the challenge for us is to integrate this system with our CBS and SWIFT system, and like we see in the blockchain technology, have our customers on board, give them access so that, you know, they can keep track of their status of their transaction. So that's there, but it's a work in progress. Gradually, I believe that's the case with most of the banks in Nepal, where we are making a movement towards it. We are taking some step towards it. But like you said, it entails a lot of cost, a lot of expertise, and all of that is required. So it'll take time. But yes, we are moving towards it. And we have acknowledged the importance of digitalization in trade finance world. Yes.
Interesting. Thanks for that. Ian, you wanted to pitch in?
Yeah, sure. Actually, nicely, I think following on from what Chandni was saying, because we work a lot with banks around the world to identify which are the core documents that are most urgent, if you like, to be turned into what we call digital paper. This is something which is not necessarily beholden to any one particular IT architectural system or anything proprietary, but nonetheless, it's a way of turning core business documents into a digital format that's time and date stamped and can be verified as being an original document, but is kept by an enterprise on wherever they want to keep it, whether that's a USB stick or whether that's their own IT cloud supplier, it doesn't matter. So that maintains their, most entrepreneurs wish to be somewhat independent and not locked into any other particular system. And this has largely come about through two sort of vectors, if you can call it that. One is the business development support services available in a country, which have been kind of trained up for this purpose to help MSMEs get to the loan pre-qualification stage. And the other is the participation of the banks who kind of got together recognizing this challenge. For example, in Kenya with what they call the Inuka program of the Kenya Bankers Association. So instead of having a monstrous task that one bank's trying to solve or one SME association is trying to solve, they've kind of shared the burden as best they can across all of their 49 member banks. To come up with a solution which is scalable to incubators, accelerators, business development support providers, these kind of entities. You can then take that and work with enterprises, a number each one, to bring the numbers up and to lighten the administrative burden on the banking system and therefore reduce the charges and fees that they need to apply to small enterprises.
Ian, so who does that? And Kitchen, after this stream, I'd just like to follow this for a second because I think this is really interesting. So Kitchen, I'll give you, you can be co-moderator. I think you're saying that there's some questions in the chat. So just jump in, tell me, just to have someone mute me, override me, and then you can please just ask, fire them out. But Ian, before we do that, so who does that for you? Like, for example, if you were to go to Lakshmi Bank or some other bank, or maybe we could partner and do something like what you're describing for Kenya, like in Nepal and some of our other countries, who actually does that? And how do you determine, you know, which documents are for digitalization and which, by which standard they're digitalized? You know what I mean? Like they're And then Hannah, if you have anything to in response, and Chandni, and welcome, just pitch in without me. So Ian, who does it?
We've been kind of leading that, if you like, and also in She Trades, I hasten to add, for our women entrepreneurs, yeah. But we do that because we have this position of impartiality. So we've been working
with banks. Ian, would you go into the bank? You mentioned Bankers Association in Kenya. Mm-hmm. So could we do that just for banks to digitize their trade documents?
Look, what we're working on here is actually lowering the cost of onboarding the enterprises. Yeah. Okay. So we're working very much with the banks are comfortably providing to us their lists of key documents, the criteria, conditions, et cetera, et cetera. We assemble that, you know, because they're actually not so different in reality. So we assemble that into a composite table, and then we work with the enterprises, with the business development support services, as we call them, which can take many different forms, but generally we upgrade them, help them to assist enterprises in the digitization pathway, and then help them prepare groups of enterprises through a sort of bootcamp process to comply with the requirements, assemble their documentation, coach them in how to do that. So then when they approach a financing provider, everything should be nicely in order.
Understood. Yeah. That's really an opportunity to work with.
We'd love to be able to do more of that.
Yeah. Well, at the beginning of the pandemic, and Hannah, it would be interesting to hear your view on this, and Chandni as well. At the beginning of the pandemic, we had a webinar for all of our banks. Chandni, I don't know if you participated in that one, and we had some companies that specialize in digitalizing trade documents. Mm-hmm. We had Bolero and Wave and S-Docs talking about how to do that, and how they would be very happy to work with banks to do that, and banks' clients as well. Hannah, is that the best way to do that? And I know you guys, the Digital Standards Initiative, is plugged in, and those companies and others are that specialize in digitalizing those documents are working with you guys. Anything to add in there? Is that the way that we would do that?
Yes, thanks, Stephen, and thanks, Ian, for mentioning that exciting initiative that you're working on to actually look at some of the common documents that are being prepared by entrepreneurs for submission to banks and other service providers, as you mentioned. So, in fact, this is something coincidental. We just had that meeting with the Industry Advisory Board last week, and this is also some of the topics that we discussed in terms of how to standardize the common trade documents across the chain. And some of these would be common things that we all recognize, like the bills of lading, commercial invoices, packing lists, things that banks require and also other actors in supply chain would require. And also underneath those documents, which are the data elements, right, that actually reappear time and time again, it needs to be retyped and rechecked every time you move that piece of paper across the board. So that is something that we are busy working on. And this is something that I think is of the highest priority for us in the year coming forward, Steve, because this will actually underlie, before we talk about trusted and reliable and verifiable data exchange, using whichever technology or vendor or solutions that we can think of, we need to actually standardize that the data that flows through the channel first. So that is the first order priority for us at the DSI. And we would, of course, welcome contributions from any interested parties or organizations who would actually be able to contribute to this process. Very much welcome.
So it might be worth mentioning here just briefly, Stephen, and I think off the top of my head, it was the 2018 edition of the ICC Annual Trade Survey. We actually had BCG do some work specifically on what you're describing, Hannah, in terms of the number of data elements, how many of them are duplicated, which ones are actually unique that add value in the trade transaction. So there's if you haven't plugged into that through your industry advisory group, that might be one useful resource to get a look at.
Yes, thank you, Alex. I think we all remember that chat, that wonderful chat with 80 data elements and 5,000 interactions. So just imagine the order of magnitude, all this get repeated time and time over. So that actually is a very excellent resource. Thank you for reminding that.
Guys, if I can just do a little plug for DSI. I mean, if anyone's interested in participating in these efforts to to standardize and so on. I mean, there are lots of sort of working groups and subcommittees and all that sort of stuff through ICC in general. And if there's an interest in getting involved, then please, you know, let any of us know and we'll get you plugged in. Chandni, anything you want to pitch in at this point, or should we go to Kijin if he has some questions from the audience? Chandni, you with us?
Yes, Stephen. Sorry. Yes, if just to add a little bit to what was being said earlier, if we were to decide on which documents are to be digitalized first or digitized first, I think in Nepali's context, it should be the documents which are mandatory from our central bank, that's Nepal Rashtra Bank. I think we can make a start from there. And any contribution from our side, I think we'll be happy to provide that. Yeah.
Hey, Chandni, if this is something you want to pursue with the Nepal Bankers Association or something with us, then please reach out and Roberto and I can maybe talk about it some more and loop in some of our partners and see if we can move forward. Thank you. Kijin, are there some questions from the audience
I didn't mean to intervene just for the questions. So maybe you have a chance to look at the questions. Yeah, we got just two questions from the audience. It's about MSMEs, and then the other one is about women-led businesses. So I think I'll just read it out loud. So the first question is, could you suggest some means to access international financing, similarly for local MSMEs, because they have complained that accessing financing locally such cumbersome process, especially in Nigeria, Africa. So this has led to so many SMEs out of business. That's for the first question. And then the second one is in relation to that, to how can informal business, particularly women-led business, can survive, in terms of getting access to finance. So I guess Hannah has something to say about the first question.
Yes, thank you, Kijin. So mindful of time, I will actually put a link into the chat box to introduce you to our ICC global campaign to support MSMEs with innovative trade finance solutions. So the campaign is called ICC Trade Now. So I'm just going to put that link for resource into the chat box. And please get in contact with us to talk about some of the things that we could do for you. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Hannah. Ian?
Yeah, thank you. There are, of course, a number of international providers. I think a lot here depends on the scale of financing that people are looking at. There are a lot of smaller scale digital financing providers that can help, but generally they go up to a maximum of $20,000-$30,000 per loan as such. And you have to look at the rates they charge, you know, the annualized rates. It looks small on a monthly basis for short term. When you annualize that, you're getting up to 30-40%. So I think the fair thing to say is that globally we're working on it, not just us, but other agencies as well. And they're also, I'm going to put up a link in a second for our sheet trades and our SME Trade Academy, because there are several other links that people can follow on those two facilities.
Thanks, Ian. Can I just go back to Hannah again? Because I think, do you want to give more of a plug to that that link you just provided, Hannah? Because correct me if I'm wrong, and I'm remiss in not knowing more about it. I think we could do more to publicize this thing. But basically, the link that you put up is for a platform to actually provide the MSMEs with more trade financing. Is that correct?
Yes, correct. You are right, Steve. So actually, it's an online platform that we actually link up with a few innovative trade finance service providers. And so through this platform, we are actually able to connect the MSMEs with this trade finance service providers because they are already set up under this campaign specifically to serve MSMEs. So it's a very targeted aim that we have over here. And we have selected or curated a group of service providers who are actually able and willing to provide such financing. And in fact, we have continuously try to expand this pool of trade service providers who are willing and able to support SMEs. So in fact, last week when our Secretary General was in Singapore, he actually met with local fintech providers in Singapore who are also targeting this SME segment. So everywhere that we go, we are trying our best to add onto this pool of liquidity providers, specifically for SMEs. So this campaign will continue, and I think we do have a very big focus in Africa. So I do hope that this is able to do something for our audience member who is having this question. Thank you.
Well, thank you for that, Hannah. And Ian, maybe there's an opportunity to put this link that Hannah's provided into SheTrade itself. Yep. So that all those MSMEs and, you know, operating through SheTrade could you know, access that thing and see how it goes. So thanks for that. So there, I guess, is the answer to that question. Pretty good.
Stephen, can I just add one observation to that?
Please.
And that's just at it, thank you, just at industry level very quickly. And it's about broadening the use of financing techniques. So we spend a lot of time talking about letters of credit and traditional mechanisms. One of the areas where we think, and Stephen, it goes back to your introductory remarks about the definitions work that we did a few years ago, to try to advance global understanding of certain techniques of supply chain finance. And there's one in particular called payables finance, where the SME working with their buyer can gain access to affordable trade finance off the back of the credit standing of their buyer. So they're not paying what they would normally pay based on their own risk and credit profile and all the onboarding challenges, Hannah, that you mentioned, but rather it's the buyer, their banker, and the supplier community, especially the strategic suppliers, even the SMEs and the MSMEs, gaining access to finance because the buyer determines that it makes sense for the overall health of the supply chain. And so that payables finance technique is one where we could raise awareness and work with the local larger banks to sort of deploy those types of solutions. So we think that's one promising and as yet under-leveraged technique that could be looked at for developing in emerging markets in particular.
Yeah, Alexander, thank you for mentioning that. That's a whole area that I don't think we've had time to mention. The supply chain finance, Asian Development Bank, we're in the process of scaling that business. And we're going to be working and are working with a number of banks in our countries of operation, like in Nepal. Chandni, are you guys involved in our capacity building to provide supply chain financing? Is Lakshmi not yet?
Well, not yet.
Yeah. Okay, well, we're starting to roll that out. And that's, thank you for mentioning, Alexander. That's a huge, huge opportunity, I think, to close SME financing gaps. Definitely. Guys, what time are we supposed to end? So that's really a bad moderator. I don't even know when it's supposed to end.
So we already used all our time.
Yeah. Okay. It's 5:30.
The nightmare moderator. Okay, guys. Well, thank you so much. I've had a lot of fun, and I'm never going to be on a panel that any of you are moderating because you need to get me back for this, I'm sure. So thanks a lot.
Thanks, Stephen. Thanks.
It's been really interesting and informative. And I think there's stuff for us to follow up on. I mean, the possibility of the Nepal Chamber of Commerce adding that link from Hannah into SheTrade, us working with SheTrade and other stuff. So thank you so much. And thank you for putting up with the unknown that came your way.
Thanks, everybody. That was fun.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.
And for the audience, don't hesitate to reach out to all of us, okay? Thank you.
Thank you.